getting ready to destroy the earth with the deluge, with the flood. Wickedness and violence had grown rapidly at this time, and every thought and every imagination of man high was only evil, continued as evil. Continually, there's no reprieve, there's no break, there's just evil. That's a wicked, that is a depraved, pernicious society that only think evil. Continue. It got so bad that God had repented. It repented God, the Bible said. And it repented the Lord that he had made man on earth. It repented the Lord that he had made man. He had a change of mind or of heart. Not so in repent to where you understand God has sinned, because God is sinless. When that word repent is attached to God, it deals with a change of mind. It deals with a change of mind. It had repented the Lord that he had made man. Let us pray. Father God, it's once again, I thank you, Lord, for the opportunity, Lord, to teach your word, Lord. To teach your word, Lord. Father God, allow your word to inform and transform us today, Lord. The teaching today, allow it to inform us, Lord, but not only inform us, Lord, but transform us, Lord, that we may be wiser, that we may be better, Lord. If I have committed any sin, Lord, I pray that you forgive me right now, Lord, and hide me behind the cross, Lord, that, Father God, you may be glorified, the body of Christ, Lord, edified, Lord. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
I want to read verse 7 and 8 for today's subject. We left off at verse 6. In the verse 6 at the end said, and it grieved him at his heart. And it grieved him at his heart. Talking about God. You see it? That he made man. And it grieved him. Lord have mercy. At his heart. At his heart. By way of intro, let us deal with verse 6 before we move on. It said, and it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth. It repented the Lord. Somebody, I need somebody to help me today. Somebody get 1 Samuel chapter 15, verse 29, and the same chapter, verse 11. It says, and it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth. He had a change of a mind, because man had changed his mind. Now, when man changed his mind, God would change his mind. Man turned away from following God, and God, you understand, it repented him. He had a change of a mind. When it came to his creation, that's tough. Somebody got it?
Come. 15, 27?
15 to 29.
15 to 29. And also the strength of Israel will not, let me make sure I'm right.
Yeah. That's it.
Okay. And also the strength of Israel will not lie nor repent, for he is not a man, but he should repent.
Stop right there. Read it one more time.
And also the strength of Israel.
And also the strength of Israel.
Will not lie.
He will not lie. Who is the strength of Israel? That's God. And also the strength of Israel. He will not lie. Keep on deep.
Nor repent.
Nor repent.
For he is not a man.
For he is not a man.
That he should repent.
That he should repent. God cannot lie. So meaning that he is without sin. You understand? He is not a man that he should repent. So when the word repent, you understand, it's in the same syntax, and it's referring to God, meaning that God had a change of mind. Not that he sinned. Because he cannot lie. To lie is a sin. He's not man that he should. Alright. Just want to get some understanding with somebody. Read verse 11 of the same chapter. Somebody got it?
11?
Yeah.
And Samuel came to Saul.
And Samuel came to Saul.
And Saul said unto him. No, wait a minute. Excuse me. 11, you say?
Yeah.
It repented me. That I have set up Saul. To be king. For he has turned back from following me.
Okay. So God got a change of mind. It repented God that he have set up, you understand, Saul as king. Why? Because he have turned what?
Back from following me.
From following me. So Saul turned on God, and now God had it. Come on, Dave. Yeah, sure.
11.
Uh-huh.
I regret that I have made Saul king. Because he has turned away from me.
Because he have turned. He have turned. Repent. He have turned away from me.
And has not carried out my instructions.
So you understand that word repent meaning God had a change of mind because Saul had a change of mind, not that God sinned. Okay? Not that God sinned. So we go back to Genesis 6 and 6, and it said, and it repented the Lord that he had made man on the earth, and it grieved him at his heart. It grieved him. He was sorrowful. Grief is an emotion. It's a deep emotion. There's a word called anapapathia. It's where we ascribe human emotions and human feelings to God. So God was grieved. He was sorrowful because that he had made man. And the only remedy now is the flood. So we talked last week from the subject cataclysmic remedy. Where the world will be baptized in the deluge. The world will be cleansed. The earth will be cleansed by the flood. The flood. And now I want to talk from 7 and 8 today. It says, and the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, and the creeping things, and the fowls of the air, for it repented me that I have made them. Verse 8, but Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Just want to talk today from the subject, but Noah. But no. Is that okay? Okay, let's see. Can we exegete verse verse 7 for a minute here. It says, and the Lord said, here he is, God talking. This God. And the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth. God is going to destroy man from the face of the earth. Somebody read 6 and 13 for me. Same chapter, Genesis 6 and 13.
And God said unto Noah, the end of all flesh is come.
The end of all flesh is come.
Before me. For the earth is filled with violence through them, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth.
All right. The earth is now, it's filled with violence. And God said, I will destroy. We see that repetitively throughout the scripture. I will destroy. And God says it, he's going to do it. Amen. His word will not return unto him void. It's tough when God said, I will destroy. It said, and the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth. My sisters and brothers, we might have a problem with that. And oftentimes we do have a problem sometimes with God, amen? When God go to destroy things that he has gave to us, loaned to us, amen? And when God go to destroy the thing that he has given to us, long to us for a minute, we have a problem. Mm-hmm. But it all come from him. We have no problem with God giving, but we have a problem when God come back and take. For the Lord give it and the Lord take away. Blessed be. Hello? Oh, yeah. Right. Why you take my loved one? I done heard that time after time again, D. Why? But you didn't say that when your loved one was born and God gave them to you. But God sometimes give us people only for a season. He said, I will destroy. God can destroy whatever it is that he want to destroy. Look, I just want to read this verse. It's a well-known verse from Psalm 90, number 3, and it reads as thus, thou turneth man to destruction, he turneth. He pulverized man. He turned him to destruction. Now, God does this. I will destroy. He turneth man. He pulverized him. He sends them back to the ground from whence they came. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. He said, and the Bible said, thou turneth man to destruction and said, returneth ye children of man. But we don't have a problem when God give people to us. But we have a problem when God take people away from us. In Genesis 6 and 7, and the Lord said, I will destroy man, watch this, whom I have created from the face of the earth. Whom God have created, amen? And God created whatever it is he created. He can destroy it whenever Whenever, you hear me? Whenever
get ready.
Sometimes we don't appreciate our loved ones. Sometimes we think we're going to have them forever, you understand? And then we don't amend the things that need to be amended. And God sometimes put a recall on them. And that's why you have people trying to jump in a casket. That's why you have people crying. That's why you have people can't let go, because they never know when God's going to put a recall. He's telling them right now. He said, the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast and the creeping things and the fowls of the air. Both man and beast and the creeping things and the fowls of the air. God gave man dominion over the beast, over the fowl of the air, and over the creeping thing. But God getting ready to destroy man in the things that he gave man dominion over. Because man had became wicked, and they had became violent. And now God is getting ready to destroy. And look what it said. For it repented me that I have made them. That's bad, you understand? It got so bad, so evil, because the sons of God, the fallen angels, saw the daughters of man, that they were fair, and they went in to them, and now you have this pernicious, hybrid, wicked, you understand, creation that's violent, that's evil, that's corrupt, and God gave them 120 years to come to him and try to get it right, but they did not want to. It said, for my spirit shall not always strive with man, seeing that he's flesh. But God give us chance. Mm-hmm. He give us chance. He sends us evangelists. He sends preachers by our way. You understand? But he give us chance. He sends us leaders. He give us chance. But oftentimes we reject the ones that he sent to us.
Mm-hmm.
He sent us good teachers. And yet we won't come out to be taught, to learn, to be informed and transform. He sent us good teachers, and yet we get lackadaisical. We reject only to our own detriment.
Mm-hmm.
And you wonder what you have done. You see, the time will come when they're not gonna wanna. It's here. There's gonna be a great falling away. Apostasy. We see it right. That's just a premonition. That's just a sneak preview back as of what's to come. Somebody, I'm moving ahead of myself, but somebody get Matthew 24 verse, starting at verse 36. This just a premonition, and we in those days. We in those days. Signs of the time. What's to come? Somebody got it?
But of that day and hour, no one knows, not even
what
that.
What verse is that?
36.
Okay, Q, go ahead.
Not even the angels of heaven.
No one knows. That day, the day that the Lord come back, no one knows. Not even the who? The angels in heaven. Come on, keep reading.
But my father only.
But his father, okay.
But as the days of Noah were.
As the days of Noah were.
Uh-huh. so also will the coming of the Son of Man be.
All right.
For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage.
Hello?
Until the day that Noah entered the ark.
Amen. They were getting down. They were partying. You understand? They didn't think this was going to happen. Like I say, they never seen rain. Preacher, what is he talking about? It's going, what? You out your mind, preacher. What? Matter of fact, what is rain? They never seen rain. Blessed are those that believe that have not seen. They never seen rain. And sometimes we wonder if the preacher really know. Preacher, why are you preaching that, sir? Huh? It's a reason. It's a reason. They were eating, they were drinking, they was marrying, they had some of the best. Yeah, you know. I'm just being real. They weren't drinking no mess. They was drinking real good. They were eating good. They had a nice spread laid out. You understand? They was married. And then they was giving in marriage. You already married and you still want to marry some more?
Really?
Right. Right. That's what was going on. That is what was going on. Look at verse 8 says, but I like that. But in essence, contrary to them, here we got a but. God, we went to see this old lady in a nursing home. And she said, I thought I was forgotten about. And she said, God always got a rambling in the bush. There's always a but, you understand? The Bible said, but Noah. I like that, but Noah, you understand? Noah mean comfort, mean rest. He shall give us rest from our toil. That's what his daddy named him, Noah, and his daddy was prophetic. Lamech was prophetic. Lamech conquered. He named his son Noah. He shall give us rest concerning our toil. And now we have a but right here. You understand? Everybody is wicked. Everybody is, they walking away from God. You understand? They're doing what they want to do. But there is always dig a but. But no, amen. But no, but here it is. But the preacher, everybody can do everything but the preacher. Huh? Preacher can't do nothing. Everybody can go here, they can go there, they can miss this, they can miss that. But the preacher, he here, they lift him to a higher standard. Really? Even though he's human, that even though he had the same makeup, even though he had like passions, he expect to live different than the ways of the world, you understand? And the Bible said, but Noah, he found grace in the eyes of the Lord. He found grace, D. Among all these antediluvian wicked people, did Noah found grace? Isn't that something? God elected him to be his man, to preach his word. Noah found grace. And matter of fact, really what happened is Noah received grace. Because it's an unmerited favor, huh? It's a limitless favor given to one that don't deserve it. If I could earn grace, you can count me out. Because I can't earn it. I can't earn it. I'm too messed up to earn grace. It's an unmerited faith. Huh? No foul grace. Grace, charisma, grace, unlimited kindness and favor in the eyes of the Lord. Isn't that something? He found grace. He found grace. And just because he found grace, Pastor, doesn't mean that it was easy. Huh? One easy. Let's keep on reading. Let's go on. These are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man. Hold on. He found grace. An unmerited, limitless favor in the eyes of the Lord. And Noah believed in God by faith. And therefore Noah was justified. He was considered righteous in the eyes of God. Watch this. It said, these are the generations of Noah. Noah was a just man. And hold on, he was just. He was a righteous man. Hello, the preacher, you not righteous in the sense that Noah did not sin. Huh? He was made of the same stuff. He had the same desires we had. But he believed in God by faith. That's what made him just. You understand? And look what it says. It says that imperfect in his generation. Not being perfect, not meaning without sin. That word perfect in the Greek means teleos, meaning mature, meaning complete. You understand? God did it all. God did it all. You understand? It's not about my righteousness is as filthy. God did it. Hello? Did it all. And Noah, here it is. He walked. He walked with. Hello? He walked with God. He walked with God. You know when a person is. It's walking with God. You know it. You don't even have to say much. People know when you're really walking with God. You don't have to have no big old Bible, you understand it? And when people say, how you doing? Blessed and highly favored in the Lord, praise the Lord, turn around three times, reach up and you ain't gotta do all that. They know. Pastor, they know when you're walking with the Lord, you understand? Grace allowed Moses deep to get close, huh, to the Lord. Not that he earned grace, an unmerited favor. Grace through faith, he was justified, perfect, complete. He can walk with God, amen? Habitually, he can, but it was by faith that he was able to get close and to walk with God. And not only that, now that he's close, now that he's walking with God, God got a plan for Noah's life. Thank God he had a plan for our life. That's why we're here today. That's why the devil wanted Noah, but he couldn't get to Noah. He wants you. Don't think he don't want you. Hmm. He wants you. But the only thing that's keeping you here is God. Invulnerable grace got you covered. Right. It's not our goodness that got us covered. It's God's grace that got us covered. That's what got us covered. That's why we keep coming out when ain't nobody else coming out yet. God's grace. God, don't get discouraged. We keep our eyes on the Lord. You understand? Don't get discouraged. Who don't come? Who come? Who drop off? Because you understand, we have to come for the right reason.
All right.
Anytime we're not coming for the right reason, we bound. Don't come for Lafayette. You're bound to quit if you come for me. But if you genuinely love the Lord and love God's word, it ought to. And even with that deep, have to be careful. Because we live in a time when they will no longer. All I'm teaching is the Bible. I don't have no ideology, no philosophy of Lafayette to get. All I have is the word. And that's all you need. For whatever situation you're in, you can find it to help you meet whatever in the word. The word of God. Word of God. My sisters and brothers, I stop by to tell you that Noah's task was not easy. Wasn't easy. This thing called preaching is not. It's not. Don't let nobody fool you. Mm-hmm. It's not easy. I wish some of the antagonists, mm-hmm. the folk that raise all the WELL, come on and try it. The ones that think that they know how to do it, they know how to pastor, come on and try it. See, what people love, they love watered down, sugar-coated, make me feel good messages, D. And by the time you get them out to the sidewalk, what the preacher preach about? Oh, so, where did he? What chapter? They don't know. But they was caught up in emotional, feeling good. Now you go through the weekend. Here come the devil. You don't have nothing to
hold you.
Now don't get me wrong. Preaching is emotional, huh? It is emotional. But you preach, you get emotional to convict. Huh? Oh, we don't like to be convicted. Oh, thank God. I might just run downstairs. We don't like to be convicted. I get convicted, D. Huh? But I don't want to stay convicted. Convert me. Change me. Peter, when you're converted, strengthen the brother. Strengthen, D. Keep strengthening the brother. Strengthen them. Strengthen the brother. It's not easy preaching and teaching. You understand? Y'all have studied. You understand? And spent hour studying the layman lessons and no one show up. Get discouraged. I know it has to. It got to 66 years and no one but the faithful few is still showing up. And if you're not careful, hear me out, you can begin to psychoanalyze your own ministry. What am I doing? You going to sleep, you putting your hell, then I teach the thing. It ain't even about you. You ain't did nothing wrong. It's the time that we're living in. And if you get one deep, thank God for the one. Hello?
Y'all with me? Amen.
Huh? Y'all with me? If you get one faithful one, that's worth coming down here, open up the doors, if you can get one. Because you never know what God gonna do with just
the one.
Really? James Mafferty, young boy going to Sunday school, only one in class to end up being one of the greatest theologians. Just check the history out that the world have ever known. What if his Sunday school teacher quit teaching because he was the only one in class? Somebody read 2 Peter 2 and 5. Start at verse 4. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4 and 5. It's not easy. We teach, Pastor. We teach. I'm trying to blend both of the two right now, preaching and teaching. But we teach to inform. See, it's different from preaching. Do you hear? It's a little different from preaching. We teach to inform and transform, to change. We teach. We preach to convict and convert. Now, Noah, the boy was a preacher. Hello? We dog people until we get to really, really get inside and take. You know what I mean? We dog them because they built in the ark. But when they got in the ark, Noah was saving, they drowned, but we dogged them. Why? You got to get inside that thing to really get a revelation. You understand? Come on, read it, somebody. 4 and 5.
For thus have given to us exceedingly great and precious promises.
Is that 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 4 and 5? I'm almost done.
For God did not spare the angels who sinned, but cast them down to hell and delivered them into chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment.
Amen. He delivered them down to chains of darkness to be reserved for judgment. Those angels that left the first estate, they got uncannily evil. He had to change. Come on, finish reading.
And did not spare the ancient world, but saved Noah.
He didn't. God did not spare the ancient world. Here. But he saved who? Come on, church. He saved Noah. Keep reading, Pastor.
One of eight people.
One of eight. Hold up, D. This is what I'm getting at. One of two, four, six, eight. One of eight people. The boy been preaching for over 100 and some years. Hooping and howling and howling and hooping. You understand? A preacher of righteousness, D. He didn't have none of that sugar-coated stuff. He told them what was going to happen. You understand? Preaching, D, for 800 years. You understand? And he probably go home at night wondering, you know, I'm preaching God's word. I'm living the best I can. I'm walking with the Lord. You understand? But don't seem like nobody want to get saved. Nobody don't want to come out to Layman Wednesday night Bible study, church on Sunday morning. They come down, they join the church, and they take the preacher hand, and then they gone out the door, and you don't see them no more. You understand? It probably weighed in on Noah. And I'm preaching and... Huh? Only 7 people listening to him. His wife, his 3 daughter-in-laws, and his son. The church ain't grown in years, but the boy preaching. And you know, that's not easy when you know you're doing God's will and you can't see no manifestation. Nothing has changed. But we walk by faith and not by sight. Some people you preach and you teach, they will never change, D. I'm being honest with you. You can teach till you're blue in the face. Preach till you turn purple and red. They will never change. You can show them the right way. They will never, ever, ever, ever change. And they'll blame you, make you think you did something. You ain't done nothing. But try to do the best you can by them. Try to show them the right way. They get down and out and say, Pastor, I need you. Give them. And they still turn on you. They'll never change something. And we beat ourselves up. What I done? Sometimes you got to let some people just go.
Amen.
I'm studying, trying to do this for you. You ain't growing. You ain't changing. You still want to do things your way. Sometimes you got to just cut them off. If you want to do it, go ahead. Hard is the way of the man that transgress. Sometimes you gotta let. I wish I can talk like I was at home. You're trying to show some big head Negro something the right way and they study going the wrong way. Let them go. And you beating yourself up late at night and know you'd have done right by the person. Running your blood pressure up, your blood pressure low, your cholesterol. You're eating, trying to go. They want to be with the world. Let them go out there sometime. Because the world is cold. And you know what? We treat cold people nice and nice people cold. We got it twisted up here because we messed up sometime. Stay in the rack. Noah's faced with this problem, what I'm saying, D. He's a preacher of righteousness. Somebody read 1 Peter 3 and 20. He's probably going home like old Reverend Simpson. Depressed, distressed, beating up on yourself. Lord, what is it that I'm doing wrong? What is it that I'm not doing? And what is it that I can do? And it don't matter because some people ain't gonna change. You gotta listen, you gotta leave that passing in God's hand. My job is to come here and sow the seed. Irregardless, who I don't know where it's falling. If it's falling on good ground, bad ground, but I know all ain't gonna fall on bad ground. Keep sowing the seed, right? The farmer can never get discouraged sowing if he want a harvest. And all seed ain't gonna fall on good ground. But hey, boy, if you want the harvest, you better keep sowing.
All right.
Somebody got that for me?
Who disobeyed long ago when God waited patiently.
God waiting patiently on it. But yet they disobeyed. Noah preaching, you understand? They reject. We don't want to hear that, Noah. We don't want to. You know it ain't going to rain. You building that ark, you understand? That big old boat, you understand? It ain't no water. No, man, you done lost your mind, preacher. Go ahead, Dave.
Okay. Patiently in the days of Noah, while the ark was being built, in it only a few people.
Hold on, this boy preaching. He preached and did 100 and some years. The Bible still talks about only. Hello. I'm talking to somebody. Don't you get discouraged. Whatever ministry you're working in, don't get discouraged. It's only going to be a few people.
All right.
Don't you get tired. Don't you get discouraged. Because people going to drop off. They going to say, I'll be there. They ain't going to show up. You understand? They want us to get discouraged. Huh? They want the faithful to give up.
Uh-huh.
Don't give up. Do you hear me? Don't give up, D. Don't give up. Huh? God will bless. Don't give up. I'm almost done. Don't give up. Quit looking at numbers. Don't give up. Sometimes you got to be tactful. I'm going to do this and get this prepared so when I get there, I don't have to do this. I'm going to get this prepared so if they don't come, I don't have to do this. I already got the, oh, and when they get the, oh, I already done that for you. Just bring it on. Because you ain't know whether or not they was going to show up. Mm-hmm. One preacher said, during her, on her committee, guess what it got down to? Don't look at the numbers is what I'm telling you. And Bible, read that again, D.
Okay, the whole thing.
Yeah.
Who disobeyed long ago when God waited patiently.
He waited patiently.
Of Noah.
Uh-huh.
While the ark was being built.
Uh-huh.
In it, only a few people, 8 in all, were saved through the.
So don't get caught up on the numbers. Don't get caught up. Don't get discouraged. Because listen, those that God, hear me out, won't And they, I'm being real. And that's why I tell them, don't come from the Lord. You understand? Don't come for the, you understand? Because I might do something to make you mad and you go, huh? Because when they come for the Lord, they going to stay.
Yeah.
Boat might rock, but they going, huh? They going to stay. Out of all this preaching, Linda, only 8 people. But he had to keep going. God can do great things with just 8. Huh? Gonna repopulate. Amen. 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 We close. Thank you for your. But no. Thank God for the buttons. But no. You understand? Some people think this is just a fictional story. It's just to be put in little kids' color books, the art, you understand? That old preacher of righteousness. You know, they don't believe it's real. Huh? They think it's... But Jesus quoted, as in the days of... We know that it's non-fictional. We know it's real. Huh? We know it's real. Amen? God is good. It's a real story. The boy kept preaching on the 8 souls. And listen, in closing, what the writer wants us to pay attention to, not so much as to the flood. No. Not so much even the wicked population. He wanna, huh? He want us to pay attention on his delivering power. Asom. No matter how wicked things get, God has power to deliver. He still has power to save and save to the utmost. But you got to come in the ark. Got to come on in the house. Come on in. I'm going to stop right there. I want to talk about that later. All right?